Welcome to Business Leader Breakthroughs, where we help unlock the potential in you, your teams, and your business. I'm your host, Ryan Castle, along with Dr. Mike Ashby. We'll share insights, experiences, and stories on achieving breakthrough success in business and life. In addition to a podcast, The Breakthrough is a coaching and advisory business that provides programs for business leaders, owners, and managers to develop your skills and capabilities to boost your business and enjoy a better life. To learn more, click the link in the episode show notes or go to thebreakthrough.co. Now let the breakthroughs begin. Mike, welcome along to this episode of the podcast.
Thanks, Ryan. Good to be here, mate.
Yeah, great to have you here. Look, I want to talk today about board reports.
Yeah.
And the fact that board reports are not for the board.
Good idea.
Seems a little odd, maybe. And I'm sure we have a wide range of businesses that join us on the podcast, some probably from reasonably small through to quite large. Some of you probably have governance structures in place now. You may already have a board. For those of you that don't, I think some insights that we can share with you today will be really, really valuable. We have our own board. We have a single person board report. So in addition to Mike and myself as the owners, we have a very, how should we describe Dan?
Painful.
Painful in such a good way. He is so insightful.
And challenging.
Look,
it's cruel,
yeah,
isn't it?
I never look forward to board meetings because I just know I'm going to get asked the hard questions. Look, he won't even let Mike have the mouse and keyboard control. He's like, get away! I'm controlling that. But look, my idea around...
He mocks us.
Yeah, yeah.
He kind of looks at us and he just laughs when we say things that,
well, I think...
Can't get away with stuff.
Fundamentally, he holds us to account.
Well, yeah, there's that.
Right? Which is... quite good for a someone who is a pioneer by nature, very big on ideas and, oh, we could do this and we could do that. And I have a reasonable dose of pioneering me as well, so I'm always thinking that's good as well. But he holds us to good account and tests those ideas for us.
A bit of blather as well. I have a little blather which, you know, can kind of use words to weave my way out of, but don't get away with that, which is good.
So, in addition to our own board, Mike, obviously we both chair boards for other organisations. Yep. What do you see as the value of having that external perspective involved in the business?
From the external perspective, I think the independence and the objectivity. You know, that's the real value of having an external advisor, is somebody who is not beholden to, hasn't kind of drunk the, what is it?
Kool-Aid?
Smoke the exhaust pipe, whatever,
No, I'm not sure where that analogy's going.
No, that's something about breathing the exhaust fumes or something.
Oh, right. Doesn't that kill you, carbon monoxide?
I think it does, actually. Yeah. What is it, that thing? So I drank the Kool-Aid, thoroughly immersed in the way things are done around here, and part of that groupthink, and having all those kind of why we can't and why we must and blah, blah, and they kind of...
What, it's the bias, something bias.
Is it groupthink?
Britt has another one where she goes, what's the, when you bring a bias to a decision, there's like a term for that kind of bias. The benefit of having someone external is they don't arrive in the room with that bias because they haven't been sitting around drinking the Kool-Aid going, oh, this idea's going to be great.
Or this is why we can't possibly do that. Or this is why, So that's the real benefit from bringing an advisor in, is that objectivity, that kind of tell the truth. We call it in the, when we've been working with advisors or suggesting to people, it's the bright light, the clear mirror, and the kick in the pants. And that's still a pretty good way of putting it, really.
So tell us about those three things.
Well, the bright light, particularly in what we do, less so the external advisors, but partly. You know, Dan brings... his experiences and insights from different industry, different experience set, and says, hey, this is what we could do here. Here's the bright light on a possible future. And you're like, oh, yeah, okay, that sounds pretty good. The clear mirror is somebody who'll tell you, honestly and to your face, you know, this is how you look at 7 o'clock in the morning after a hard night. You know, you don't actually look that pretty.
Yes.
Or you look great.
Yep.
You know, your makeup's looking sweet. you do is, you know, so both are really important. You don't need somebody who just bags you the whole time. Yes. You need somebody who also says, you're doing this really well. Because as business owners and leaders, we tend to underestimate both. Mm-hmm. You know, we tend to gloss over our failures and we tend to undervalue our successes.
Totally.
So somebody who's going to tell us you're good or you're not, that's really helpful. Mm-hmm. And then the kick in the pants, which sort of speaks for itself, really. Like, you know, why haven't you? Why not?
Well, this was on the minutes from the last board meeting. Why is it not complete? And doesn't seem to, the excuses don't really seem to wash.
Like so, doing the kicking, don't like getting kicked.
Yeah, indeed. Look, I've come to deeply appreciate the discipline of board meetings.
I
don't always enjoy them. They are regularly tough conversations.
You handle them well, Ryan. You never seem flustered. Wow.
I'm not sure if flustered, tears. Frustrated, maybe. But look, the discipline of board meetings I find so valuable for me as a leader in this business. Mm. The discipline to go every single month, I've got to stop, review the performance of how we've gone over the last month and how that's tracking year to date. Look at it not only from a financial perspective, but look at it from a people and capability perspective. Look at it from a customer perspective. Mm. Look at it from a partner perspective.
Mm.
And go, how are we going here? What did we say we'd do, and what have we done? And then, of course, look, the financial review comes into it, an important bit. But I do want to highlight that just doing a financial review doesn't work.
It's not enough.
I think we, if you're only looking at historical financials, you really are trying to drive your business looking through the rearview mirror. Look, they're an important part, but not the only part. But the forced discipline for me every month to have to write the board report, as I do.
Yes, he does.
Review the performance across those areas, provide comment and insight as to why things are performing the way they are. And look, some of them are performing great and some of them are not going as fast as we would like.
Yep.
And I think that would be common to all businesses. So the forced discipline to make me stop, think, review is really, really valuable. And I also have two people that I deeply respect in the room, being you, Mike, and also Dan. So I'm very conscious of going, I've got a couple of hours with these guys. What would be the very best thing we could do to spend time discussing?
Mm.
So, you know, always on that agenda for the board meeting is and what needs to be discussed.
Mm.
So it's a great time for me to talk about barriers we're facing in the business, to think about strategic goals that we've got and how they're performing, to review our most important goals, which we're really, really clear on, and to have that insight and that dedicated time to do it is so valuable.
Mm. And it is. It's just, you know, we talked about it last time in terms of carving out time.
Yes.
This is another carve out from the whirlwind and the list of things to do. And it's taking time to take an overview of the business, where it's going, where it's been, where we want it to head, what the issues are and what we need to do to make it go better.
Mm-hmm.
I suppose it always surprises me a bit. I've had quite a lot of board experience over both as a report to, but in particular as an advisor director.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember, you know, quite early on when I was on the board of a kiwi fruit company, a large kiwi fruit company, we'd go into the board meeting and thinking, oh, well, it looks pretty straightforward. You know, there's not much in the board pack, blah, 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 blah. And then we'd be into it, you know, and we'd find ourselves donkey deep into a particular issue.
Yes.
And I find that quite a lot with any board, including our own, where we, you know, sometimes we don't get to the items for discussion because we've been discussing something that came up earlier.
Yes.
And as we've dug into it, we've gone, this is a kind of rich vein of understanding. Mm-hmm. This is not a distraction. We don't do operational stuff in the meeting. We do serious strategic stuff in that meeting. And it's the most recent one I was at is relatively informal, and we've only just started, but the discipline of the guys writing their reports has opened up a whole lot of conversations. And the one we just had, and I love that company. You know, the operations guy for the first couple of meetings, he hand wrote his board report.
Oh, gold.
I love it.
It's really authentic. It's how he, you know, it's how he works. Last month he actually got it typed up. He got some help with a with a template, and he's got some, you know, he probably did handwrite it and somebody else has typed it. But that's it's not important. You know, the kind of the level of flashness is really unimportant, and volume is really unimportant. There's another board I'm on where, oh, you know, there's a kind of, if I printed it out, I'd be accused of destroying the planet.
Yes.
And yet, the actual commentary is really light. It's one of my ongoing challenges with that organisation is, tell me what all this means. Mm. You know, the one-page executive summary with nothing in behind, where's the, so the conversation, but it, you know, we get there in the end because you go into the numbers and you start mining in. At the last meeting with my my newish board, you know, we started getting into the sales process and going quite deep into it from a kind of strategic point of view about how that works or doesn't work. And that, and we got some good clarity. That's because we had a sales and marketing guy on the board who was able to kind of, you know, get into the data and get into the process from the perspective of having worked with lots and lots of other companies. So taking the time, even though you might think there's nothing to kind of report or comment, you will always, always fill the time.
Yeah, and just the, that forced reflection is, is so useful. You know, I started this podcast by saying the board report is not for the board. Look, of course, it adds value to the board, but I think just as a leader, the discipline of creating that board report and being forced to look at the insights and the performance is really useful. Look, in another podcast episode, we'll talk about the technology we use for our board report. We use a tool called Spotlight Reporting to help us quickly generate some performance dashboards so we can get quick insight into how the performance is going. We're also using a good cloud accounting software called Xero, a good Kiwi company, that has done very well, that again allows us to get that information together quickly. So the time that I spend preparing the board report is not about gathering information. I get great help from one of my team members, Kirst, on doing that. My time around the preparation is the interpretation and the insights around it, which I think is where the value is.
It's the critical piece. You know, I say to management, tell me what it means. And I used to do that with in bigger companies as well, particularly on the financial side. And and the challenge for particularly accountants, I guess, was tell me what it means. You know, what assume I'm stupid. Tell me what these numbers mean. And that means what's the trend historically, what is it telling us about what's going to happen next, and what does it tell us about what we need to do? And the same goes for managers as well. You know, when they're covering off operations, or our other one is systemization. This is the progress I've made this month. So very briefly, how I suggest people think about their reports is, what's the progress in the last month?
Yes.
What are the issues that we need to talk about, or that we've got and we want to talk about? And what's the outlook for the next month, the outlook or focus for the next month? And that's just a nice way of going, okay, so in the last month, what have we done? What have we, what progress have we made? What issues have we got, and what's our focus for the next month?
So for our listeners that don't currently have a board structure in place, where should they start, and maybe what should they avoid?
Where should they start? Well, I think we'll probably start with their financials, because they are still a way into understanding why we're getting those results. You know, kind of tell me what it means, particularly against a budget. So I guess my very first point would be, you know, before you can probably have a board meeting, you need to have a budget. What did you expect to happen? What's actually happened? Why the variance? So I'd probably start there. I think the next piece is understanding what are those key performance indicators. You know, how do we know how we're doing? Critical, you know, there's sort of a whole bunch of things, critical success. But I think the old balanced scorecard of financial, sales, customer experience or operations, and people.
People and capability.
They're the best. This reminds me, actually, our board, we don't do the people bit.
Yes, we do.
No, our board.
Oh, the other one.
Yeah.
Good. I think the benefit often that an external advisor can bring that has some experience doing boards and advisory work is they will fast track you into getting what those KPIs and what areas of financials you should look at.
Yeah.
I wouldn't suggest taking the approach of going, I'll get everything perfect and then I'll find an advisor to help out.
Yep.
Actually leverage their knowledge and experience to do that.
That's the very first thing we did in this other board. We just went through each of their areas and said, okay, what are your three KPIs?
Yeah.
What are the three most important lead indicators,
mm-hmm.
not lag, but mm-hmm. lead indicators? And they were things like overage, you know, how many days overdue mm-hmm. were our projects,
mm-hmm.
those sorts of things. So they're the indicators of what's working and what's not working. And yeah, we spent the first meeting defining what they were, the second meeting refining, because some of them kind of, you know, the collection didn't work quite so well.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really important. It's not technical, it's strategic.
Yes.
You know, when you're getting to that level of measuring your performance in the business, it is not a technical issue. There are technical issues that sit underneath it. How you collect it, is it reliable, is it valid, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
But getting it right is a very strategic issue.
Okay, and if people are looking for someone to add an advisory capacity to their business at mm-hmm. a, you know, probably a governance level,
mm-hmm.
What should they be looking for?
I don't think they can look for people with industry experience. That can be helpful, but that can be quite hard to find. And you don't, typically, if they're people who've been in the industry, you know, they may have views about the way the industry was.
Yes.
As
yes.
opposed to yes. will be.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Get my drift. I think people who have had board experience, governance experience,
mm-hmm.
I think people who've had senior management experience, because we've always found that, you know, in terms of coaches, for example,
yes.
people with corporate experience mm-hmm. understand structures and processes.
Mm-hmm.
People who've had their own small business and then gone into coaching typically don't have that.
Yeah.
They just lack that kind of sense of process.
Mm.
And I think it's probably the biggest gift to small business is somebody who comes in with a sense of process,
mm-hmm.
process and the importance of structure.
Mm. I like to think about three things. I think you need some financial knowledge, but I'm not saying a accountant per se.
No.
They need to be a, you know, strategic advisor. Even if they are from an accounting,
they need to be commercial
mm. is key. I think some industry knowledge can be helpful, and then I think someone that has all these three that has help with your biggest strategic challenge.
Mm.
So if you're a business that's really struggling with sales and marketing, bringing someone to your board that has knowledge in that area is really, really helpful.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, there is no point sitting there talking about last month's numbers with a person who is an expert in accounting when really your biggest challenge is how do we get some more sales in the door.
Yeah.
So having some focus around, or having some capability in the room that has that. And of course, traditionally, larger boards and corporates, they have an array of people around the table which have broader skills. But there's...
I always think it's so funny at the moment. There's such an emphasis on diversity, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you see boards where they've got the required number of women, required number of ethnic groups, the required number of, you know, whatever other kind of classification, and they're all accountants.
Yeah.
You know? Zero diversity. So the only yes. point to diversity, yes. it doesn't matter who they are, is what the Defence Force, who are smart about this stuff, they get this stuff. They call it neural diversity. Diversity in the way they think.
Yes.
And that's the important thing. So you could have, seven males of exactly the same age, or females of exactly, you know, all seven. But if you've got them from different backgrounds, then you've got diversity.
Yeah.
But if you've just got a kind of, you know, a kind of pick and mix of representation and no neural diversity, you're not getting the benefit of different perspectives.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think that look for people who are different from you and think differently, mm-hmm. operate differently,
totally.
Have a different experience,
totally.
Right?
It's
but
great,
with
great
I think that senior management experience.
Yes.
I think above all else,
mm-hmm.
that's the one critical thing I would say.
Yep. totally. So look, challenge you to, if you don't already have a governance structure in place, to take some of those action steps. So start getting a review, a board pack together, because as I said, I think it's really useful for you as a leader to be to bring that together, and then look for some external independent advice to help you along on the journey. It's such a great thing. We have board meetings monthly, and I feel like they come around every 2 weeks because time just moves so fast in business.
Well, they don't feel like that anymore because I don't do the board report anymore.
Is it appropriate to hit your co-host on the podcast? I'm not sure.
I think what a good board will do is show you the shortcut.
Yes.
You know, they will actually shortcut your growth. They will stop you from going down a path of the mistakes they made. They will show you what they've learned, and they will help you get there quicker. That's really the value. They will stop you stuffing up as often as you would otherwise.
Absolutely.
And they'll get you to the good path faster.
Yes, another New Zealander, Peter Montgomery, said, "Experience is what you get right after you need it," yes. Which I think is a great quote, and that's what board members do, right? They put experience in the room, they put experience in your business, and the cost of quality board members might seem like a reasonable size number when you look at it. When they shortcut your growth, it's nothing. It's such a return on investment.
What value do you put on a good idea?
Yeah.
That's the thing. You know, that's the thing you need to get your head around is, no, they're not going to do anything. They're not going to do anything useful. But they will have an idea that will make you a lot of money or save you a lot of money. And that's really getting your head around, you know, the value of a good idea.
Team, thanks for joining us on the podcast today. Go and get that advisory structure and your board structure in place. It's what grown-up businesses do. And Thomas Watson, founder of IBM, he said, "Be today what you will become tomorrow." And I think this is just another way that if you don't have an advisory structure in place, go and make it happen. And if you have one, really maybe take a moment to reflect on some of the things we've talked about today and go, is my current advisory structure delivering what I need in there? And then make change if you need to. Thanks again for joining us today. Really appreciate you listening into the podcast. Always love your comments and feedback on your thoughts, your experiences around boards and governance and what works and what doesn't. And take a screenshot of the podcast, share it out with your friends. Thanks very much.
Cheers.